That was amazing talk by Ben. And now we have on the screen Sagar. Hey Sagar, can you hear us?
Yes, I can. Am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible. Great.
Perfect.
Let me just quickly add your slide. Yeah, I guess your slide is visible as well. And people, get ready for the next talk. Sagar, the stage is all yours.
Perfect. Thank you so much. Hi, folks. Wish you all a very good evening. And thank you for coming for my talk at PyCon 2020. The focus of this presentation is going to be on combining natural language processing as well as tabular features. And this, the context is specifically related to mapping clinical entities to the relevant section headers. So this is a bit about me. My name is Sagar Dauda. I work as a data scientist with Episource. Most of the work that we do is about designing and implementing solutions with the help of data, and I would say variety of data. Though majority of the data that we deal with is based on clinical text. So we perform a lot of MLP, I would say, medical language processing, rather than a colloquial natural language processing. And I'm also a data science mentor at an edtech startup. Some of the projects that I've been working on recently, one that we are going to discuss today, is to find the section header and mapping an entity to a relevant section header. There's one problem which was very tough and which is also pretty rewarding, is to break an entire PDF chart into different clinical encounters. And we've also built an ontology and a search engine for our entire healthcare domain, which is very specific to our corpus. And to give you a heads up about what Episource is and about my team. So Episource is a healthcare risk management firm, and we cater to big insurance providers and hospitals, and we render our services under very strict HIPAA compliant environment. So being in healthcare, you are governed by HIPAA. So we have a strong team of 20 folks, which includes data scientists, data engineers, and we also have subject matter experts, because a domain like healthcare requires a lot of expertise, and someone from a technical background and technical interest would definitely not be good at bones and flesh. So we also have strong subject matter experts for us. And together we built robust and scalable healthcare solutions, and definitely leveraging on machine learning, NLP, deep learning obviously comes as a part of it. Right. Now, before we move further, I would like to give you guys a background about what medical coding is and what is this entire cycle of medical coding, and also help you understand the importance of it. So normally, this is how it works in the US, because it's a US-based firm. We cater to the clients and the healthcare firms in the US. So a patient would check in at a general physician or maybe some specialist like a cardiologist or an ophthalmologist. And there will be an insurance verification and eligibility done to ensure that the healthcare plan supports the treatment that the patient is seeking. And then once that verification is done and the patient qualifies, the documents come to us. This patient check-in interaction with the document that comes to one of the vendors like Episource for medical coding. So this is where we capture all the coding diagnoses, the procedures, and a lot of other medical entities or clinical entities that are required. And post capturing this, it is passed on for a claim submission. And upon a verification, the claim, they are forwarded for payment processing. So Episource as an organization fits into step three. And the kind of charts that we deal with have these patient check-in interactions either for last 1 year or 2 years, depending on the requirements. So we normally deal with pretty huge charts. There are some varying from 10 pages to some almost 8,500 pages, depending on the complexity. So which is why scalability is very important factor for any solution that we build. So for people who are more curious to know about how this medical coding works and who really want to jump into machine learning specifically in the healthcare domain, you could go to this link and read more about it. Now, coming to defining what a section header is and why is it so important and what was the business objective behind it. So normally a section header will give you a gist of the content that follows, and it will also mark a change in the section within a given document. If I were to relate it to a resume, you will normally see things like BCom, MCom, or maybe an HSC or an SSC. This will come under a section called educational background or academics or something like an academic information. And then there will be another section which talks about your recent projects. So a section, that's how gives you a gist about what can you expect within this specific section. So that is what a section header will tell you. And it will also indicate that, yes, now there is a change in the content. Let me emphasize on the importance of section headers in our case. So when it comes to the clinical domain, section headers play a pivotal role in identifying the relevance of a disease. Whether a disease is relevant or it's not relevant will depend to a great extent on the section header which it belongs to. And it also identifies the current state of the disease. Now, there are certain treatments which require that it has to be in an active state for the reimbursement. So let's take an example. You have an insurance and you are suffering from fracture. Yes, your claim will be reimbursed because you are currently suffering from a fracture. But if someone identifies that this information about the fracture was in the past and it is not an active state, no one is going to reimburse you for a past fracture. So which is where your section headers play a vital role in determining what is the current state of the disease or the diagnosis that the interaction is all about. And this in turn has a direct impact on the claims or the reimbursements. Now, what is the kind of impact? I have a separate slide on it, so we will talk more about it. And having understood what section headers are and why they are so important for us, this led us to identifying two separate objectives. The first objective was to identify what these section headers within a chart are. And the second objective was, how do you map an entity to its relevant section header? Now, section headers can be very tricky, and so do the entities. It totally depends on your chart format, the layout, and the kind of text that you have. So, yeah, it boils down to what is the section that one has identified, and how do you ensure that the disease that we are talking about is mapped to the relevant section? So this is an example. Now, if you look at this chart, here additional risk factors is one of the major sections, but there are certain minor sections as well. Suicide risk, anxiety, depression, review of systems. So these are all different kind of section headers. So the first objective was to obviously identify the section headers, and then we map it with the relevant entities. Now, just like every other machine learning or a deep learning project, it will come with its own challenges, and our problem is no different than that. So these are some of the challenges that we faced. So first is, there is no standard chart format. Now, when I say no standard chart format, this is in terms of presentation or the layout. Now, there are certain standards that are available which tells you what is supposed to be included in the chart, right? So it talks about a specific kind of structure called as SOAP. They call it a SOAP format. So SOAP will tell you what should be included. So there are subjective things which talks about the past medical history, the current state the disease, what are the symptoms. Then there is an objective which talks about any associated labs or kind of any of the procedures that were done. Then there is an assessment to identify what does the condition look like after the previous treatment. And then there is a plan. So plan talks a lot about treatment and any further diagnosis that are required. So these standards, they dictate what is supposed to be included, but there will never be a how. No one can force you to provide information in a specific format. So you cannot have everything tabulated. It is not necessary that everything is going to be in proper paragraphs or sentences. And there is no guarantee that it is also going to be structured into those very specific sections. So the providers are free to choose the format layout that they wish. And this creates a lot of problem. So this is one of the problems. Second one being multiple formats within a single chart. Now, like I mentioned earlier, guys, a patient's interaction is captured for the entire 1 year. Now, if the patient has 25 visits in a year, it is not necessary it would be to the same doctor or the same provider. The patient can visit multiple doctors. So let's say the first visit maybe to a general physician, the second visit probably maybe to a cardiologist who was a specialist. The third visit maybe to a lab to get some lab tests done. So every provider is going to be different. The way every interaction is going to be captured is also going to be different. So when this information is aggregated for last 1 year or 2 years, we encounter multiple chart formats within a single document. And that really adds more complexity because you cannot build custom rules which are very specific to a certain format. And another challenge where the models, the previous models that we were using got confused, were there were certain diseases which were identified as section headers. Sometimes there are genuine cases where the diseases are section headers, but you know, there is always a problem of misclassification. And this is what the previous model was prone to. And another challenge was that the content of a section can span across multiple pages. And during this situation, if you have a header and a footer in your chart, then irrelevant sections may be picked up from there. And barring those technical or other format or layout related errors, there are certain obvious errors which can give a lot of headache. One of them being OCR error, where the chart quality or the PDF image quality may be so bad that while getting converted into text, it may be gibberish or in the words may be misspelled. So that can lead to a lot of problem as well. The text alignment in multiple column layout. So we may have a chart which could be divided into three columns, a left column, a center column, and a right column. Now there is no guarantee that the text will be in the sequence which will how a human would like to read, because it can only provide you text, but the sequence is not guaranteed in an OCR based solution. So that definitely adds more complexity. And contradicting table headers. So this is in the cases when the information about disease is tabulated. So you will have a section header called as current medical problems, and then below that you will have table headers, the problem or the name of the disease, what is the current state, is there a treatment going on, yes, no kind of thing. So such additional information creates challenges for the project. Now, to stress more on the kind of impact section headers can have, so we classified the impact into four different sections, two of which are acceptable and the other two are unacceptable. This is very similar to a confusion matrix. So the first one that we can allow, this is the ideal situation. The section identified is correct and the mapping is also valid for a given disease. So what is the outcome of this situation? Accurate and valid diseases are captured for reimbursement. And this is exactly what we want for every chart and every disease. But what happens if we have identified the correct section, but the mapping is not accurate? So I identify that my page 2 has a section header called as active problems, but the entity that is on page 2 is not mapped to my actual section header. It is mapped to some different section header. So a claim that should have been reimbursed will not be reimbursed. Why? Because a section header will define whether the state of the current disease is active or not. So this can lead to something called as undercoding. Now, when undercoding comes into picture, the reimbursement amount also lessens. So a patient will not be reimbursed for what he or she should actually be reimbursed. And this definitely leads to a lot of penalties. The other situation, which is definitely unacceptable, is the section identified is incorrect and the mapping may or may not be incorrect, but definitely a valid disease is mapped to a wrong section header. Now, what happens in this case? So a section which should have been, which was a part of a non-codable section header, that disease is mapped to a codable section. So let's say, let's take that example of fracture again. So the fracture was a situation of the past, but somehow the section header captured for it is the current problems. Now, in this case, that leads to something called as overcoding, which means the medical coders, they end up capturing additional codes. So while processing the claims, the insurance company ultimately pays out more money than what should have been reimbursed to the client. And this is directly a revenue loss for the organization. So these two situations where either your section identification is incorrect and your section mapping is also incorrect. So any one trigger within this combination can directly impact the revenue and lead to losses and may also attract penalties. So you know, this is not a good situation to be in. So you have to be very careful about dealing with these things. And obviously this is the case where the section identified is correct, but the mapping is for an invalid disease, which means the disease is that of the past, but it is mapped to a section header, which is also which also indicates that yes, this is a section for the past diseases. So when I say invalid disease, these are diseases for which there is no reimbursement as per the healthcare plan, obviously. Now, how do we solve this problem, since we know it is of prime importance? So when we started off, we took three approaches. So first was a typical sentence classification approach. The second was a linear chain CRF approach. And third one was a pure metadata approach. So I'll go over the approach overview and we'll also talk about the pros and cons. And this slide should probably give you guys a fair idea that if you have to think about solving a specific problem, which is highly dependent on your domain related features, then you may want to try out a similar approach for your problem as well. Now, if we have to, if we look at a typical sentence classification or a text classification approach, we usually tokenize the text, lowercase it, perform stemming or lambdaization if required, remove the stop words, vectorize them, either using a count vectorizer or a TF-IDF vectorizer, and then you train your model and test it on your holdout data set. And in your CRF approach, you would similarly perform all the steps of tokenization to vectorization, but then instead of a machine learning model, you would pass it on to your CRF model, something that Spacy is very good at. So we use Spacy. And then a metadata approach will only have tabular features. So you convert categories into integers if there are any categories or string in your data. You perform the necessary steps for feature selection. And yeah, stop words can be removed if you are going to add more text to it. And then you perform model training and testing. Now, what are the advantages of all these approaches? The first is, if we use TF-IDF as a vectorizer, it will give importance to rare words. And it is easy on computation as well. But the problem with this solution is, it's a simple bag of words approach, and it is going to ignore sequences and semantics. On the other hand, if we follow the CRF approach, which is, by the way, the shortlisted approach, the approach prior to what we have implemented right now. Okay, this gives more importance to the sequence and ultimately will capture the semantics. And it is also not sensitive to imbalance. So if you have an imbalanced data set, your CRFs will take care of it. But the problem here is the computational, it is computationally expensive, and it doesn't work well with unknown words or out of vocabulary data. So your typical TF-IDF vectorizers, they can be used for identifying the most important keywords, and an approach like CRF is best suited for your name entity recognition kind of problems. And if you look at the metadata approach, it works. The good things about that is it will work well with limited set of data, and there is no need for you to go for a complex deep learning approach. But the problem is it will ignore the text totally unless you include a column of text, and there can be a lot of feature overlap. So we witnessed a lot of feature overlaps, which is why this approach was immediately discarded. So this metadata kind of approach is useful for any tabular or structured data that you may have. So the drawbacks of the existing approach is a shortlisted CRF approach. So first is section headers are not really a sequence problem. Now I've given a couple of examples. So look at this. If I say chief complaint, then this looks like a relevant section header. But if there is a context or a sentence in the document which says patient is taking medications for all the conditions listed in chief complaint, so a CRF being a sequence problem, it is still going to pick this up, chief complaint, as a section header. Now, even though in reality, for this specific context, it is not a section header. All right. So this leads to something called as type 1 errors. So we end up identifying a lot of irrelevant section headers, and this can lead to unwanted mappings. Now, we know that unwanted mappings can either lead to overcoding or undercoding. And under both the situations, the company ends up losing money either as penalty or overpayment. The third problem is if you have a tabular layout or a multi-column layout, the text sequence, you are not guaranteed that it is going to be proper. So this definitely is an issue, because if the sequence is broken, the CRF approach, which relies so heavily on your sequences and it learns from your sequence, is definitely not going to work well. So this is an example of where things went wrong. So look at this, anxiety and depression here. They are actually section headers. Now we have three use cases for the CRF. We identify section headers, we identify diseases, and we also identify time attributes. So the CRF picked up anxiety and depression as diseases here. But if you look at this chart format, your fall risk, abuse and neglect, suicide risk, anxiety, depression, they are all section headers. And then within this section, there is information about this disease. Okay, so it gives information about depression. So this is not really a disease, it acts more like a section header. And here, HPI stands for history of present illness. And this was an incorrect section header that was identified. So the solution is you combine your text features along with metadata. You normalize your text, you match them with well-known headers, perform a spell correction, and add your text characteristics and positional information to get these combined features like this. So you've got vectorized operations, your vectorized matrix stacked horizontally by your metadata. And that ultimately gives you the solution. So this is what is passed on to the machine learning model, which does the section header classification. And then we have a probabilistic mapping to it. And the other additional challenges that came along with this project were memory efficient XML parsing, the processing time per chart, and the complexity versus accuracy trade-off. This is how we were able to map things properly. The obesity is the actual disease, which does not belong to problem 3 or problem 2 or orders. It belongs to impression and recommendations. So this is what we were able to achieve with the help of this hybrid approach. And some of the constraints that we take into account are the identification of the section, its position, the isolation, and the page layout. So we take into account all these heuristics, and this gave us a massive boost of 19% in the overall mapping accuracy. So we went from 67% to 86%. And that concludes the formal presentation. But I hope that was informative enough for you guys to understand that how you can combine your text features along with the metadata and how it can boost your results. I'm open for any questions that you guys may have.
Great. Thanks, Sagar. We have one question coming from Sasidhar. And okay. The question is, how much training data was used for each category? I meant in the CRF approach.
So we had taken data from approximately 55,000 charts. So we go in terms of charts, and if I have to translate that to pages, on an average, we have around 20 pages. So 55,000 charts multiplied by 20 pages. So those many number of pages was the training data for CRF.
We have another question. Mm-hmm. What was the approach to training for this? How was the data labeled?
Yeah, that's a pretty good question, in fact. So which is where our subject matter experts come into picture. Now, we had the data labeled in terms of offsets. So we first captured the offsets, and then we generated features, and the offsets were mapped to our table, and ultimately we classified them, programmatically labeled them as 1 or 0, depending on whether it's a valid section header or not. So the annotation was still a proper text-based annotation before you were able to extract the features.
We have another question. Did you try word embeddings?
Yeah, absolutely. A very good question. We did try word embeddings. In fact, the CRF approach that we are using already has a 2GB word embeddings of PubMed, which is trained on like billions of data points. But sometimes these complex word embeddings may not really be a good enough solution, because it can miss important features which your vectors like TF-IDF or CountVectorizer may capture.
Another question. What was the final model used for the hybrid features?
So we are using an ensemble of a linear model and a forest-based model, a tree-based model, rather, I would say.
Could you talk more about the application of metadata approach for medical text?
Yes. In fact, for most of the medical, not just for medical, but any specific text-based challenges that you're working on, if it relies on domain-specific information, you always have to include the metadata. Now, for healthcare in particular, we work on healthcare data which deals with a lot of medical charts. But if you're working on medical images, then there are specific metadata which is related to the imaging part as well. And that is only going to boost your performance.
Was this data annotated by humans?
Yes. Yes, it was. But by... it was by our own set of team. We haven't outsourced it.
Okay, so any data annotation tools was used?
There is an Amazon Ground Truth. That tool is used heavily by us. We also tried Prodigy, and there are a couple of other tools like Docano that we have tried in the past. They work pretty good as well.
Great. Thanks a lot, Sagar. So if the attendees, you have any other question, we have Zulip String. Go to 2020/state/Delhi, okay? 2020/Delhi, and you can ask any question with Sagar. And there were a few requests, Sagar, and people were asking about the links to the presentation and the project that you were doing. So if you have time, or whenever you get, you want to share those links on the Zulip stream, please feel free to do so.
Yes, I will share the link for this presentation.
Sure, there is one last question if you want to take it.
Yeah, sure.
Okay. Thank you. I'm just going to add that question here. And yeah, what's CSF trained like NER? Sorry, yes. CRF trained like an NER?
Yes, that is correct. A CRF was trained like an NER. So if you look at a medical chart, section header is also treated as an entity. A disease is also treated as an entity. And time attributes like your date of service or a date of birth is also treated as an entity. So we treat them as medical entities and try to extract it as an NER.
Great. Thanks a lot, Sagar. Feel free to connect with everyone on Zulip. And everyone in the attendees, if you have any other question, if you want to just connect with Sagar of Platform, feel free to reach out to him on Zulip. He'll be present on 2020/stage/Delhi stream. Thanks, Sagar. Take care.
Thank you so much. Good luck, guys.
Okay, so we are closing in on Delhi stage. This was the last presentation, last session for Delhi stage. And I guess the last session for Delhi stage in 2020. That's pretty sad, but we'll be coming back again next year. So if you enjoyed, feel free to share your feedback. Reach out to speakers in the Zulip chat. And I'm just going to make a quick announcement for what's going to happen next. It's not going to happen on Delhi stage, obviously. We'll be closing this stage now. Only one stage will be available, and that is Bangalore stage. And on that stage, we have a keynote session. Now, that's interesting. We have Terry Oda for the keynote session. Make sure you go to Bangalore session after the Delhi session. I have just quick videos lined up for you. So, yeah, maybe after the videos. Thank you.